Excellency, it is my pleasure to welcome His Excellency Mr. Malik Amin Aslam, Federal Minister of Climate Change of Pakistan. Your Excellency, you have the floor.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu alaikum. Mr. President, let me take the opportunity to first congratulate the government and people of Chile for assuming the presidency of COP25 and to convey our appreciation to the government of Spain for their support in hosting the conference in this beautiful city of Madrid. Mr. President, let us not be under any illusion. The world, as shaped by us today, is now on a war path with nature. And we, the political shapers of this situation, are collectively leading the charge brigade. While nature may be resilient, it is no longer silent. And an era of consequences is already upon us. The virulent cyclones, rising heat waves, freak floods, melting glaciers, and rising sea levels are all vivid and living indicators of not only our failing battle, but also nature's forceful reply. Mr. President, this battle against nature is not a battle that can be won, nor a battle that should be won. Instead, a collective retreat is needed to try and take nature on board, to allow its space to bounce back and to tread on a different path of ecologically balanced growth before we hit the thresholds of climate irreversibility. The politics of climate change played out in these hallowed halls unfortunately remains out of sync with this reality and the scientific evidence of climate change. If this continues, all of us may soon be destined to the dustbins of history, a history of self-inflicted destruction. Our youth is out on the streets and sees the urgency and emergency. Our scientists not only see it, but have already predicted the abyss facing us, and our economies are already draining under the burden of forced adaptation costs. So, Mr. President, let us negotiate to act and not to further delay action. Within the Committee of Nations, Pakistan solidly supports the Paris consensus, and at the same time, it faces a climate challenge which is not only unique, but equally inescapable. We contribute less than 1% of the global greenhouse gases, but yet every year we keep on climbing up the ladder of climate vulnerability. The long-term German Watch Index places Pakistan at fifth position in terms of climate vulnerability and third in terms of the economic losses borne, estimated at $3.2 billion. Within this ranking, we also join a small and unique group of countries which is consistently and simultaneously appearing on not only the yearly but also the long-term climate vulnerability index. This, Mr. President, is not an enviable position to be in, and certainly not a position of our own choosing nor of our own making, as it places Pakistan squarely on the front lines of an unfolding disaster. Climate change, as viewed from Pakistan's lens, may well be the biggest human rights violation of history, where the lives and livelihoods of billions of people has been put at risk, all due to the unbridled pollution and uncontrolled excesses of a few. Pakistan does not have an option to escape climate change. The forced climate adaptation needs remain at between $7 to $4 billion per annum. While facing this daunting challenge, Pakistan remains equally committed to raising its ambition on climate action and lead the response in shaping a new future. Mr. President, this future is possible. We in Pakistan have chosen to position ourselves to tread on our sustainable development pathway in line with the spirit of the Paris Agreement. It's a paradigm shift in our business as usual, and this is at play which involves enormous political and economic costs. Led by our Prime Minister Imran Khan's green vision and backed with concerted action, Pakistan has been making a shift towards a clean and green Pakistan. We shifted away from having the highest deforestation rate in Asia by successfully planting 1 billion trees in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa province in 4 years and increasing the provincial forest cover by 6.3%. We have now raised the bar by initiating the 10 billion tree tsunami across the whole country. Secondly, we have decided to shift away from polluting transport by framing our first electric vehicle policy, which is now targeting a 30% shift to electric vehicles by 2030. Earlier this month, the city of Karachi in Pakistan launched the world's first zero emissions metro line, which incidentally is also the first transport project under the GCF to get financing. Thirdly, a Clean Green Cities Index has been initiated in 20 cities to trigger a shift towards improved waste management and sanitation. Concurrently, Pakistan has decided to get out of its plastic addiction by banning the single-use plastic bag, which is now being enforced across the country. Fourthly, our Recharge Pakistan initiative is focused on shifting our direction by effectively managing and prudently utilizing our water resources, turning catastrophic floods into an opportunity for recharging aquifers and naturally restoring ecosystems. Concurrently, to fulfill our energy needs, we are making a purposeful transition towards renewable energy by harnessing the untapped potential of wind, solar, and hydro in Pakistan, and are targeting a huge 60% shift towards clean energy by 2030. In compliance with our responsibilities, Pakistan's second national communication was recently submitted, the National Committee on Carbon Markets has been announced, and our NDC is being updated into an enhanced NDC, and it is being financed by country finances. Also, Pakistan is now launching the Ecosystem Restoration Fund as an independent, transparent, and comprehensive financial mechanism which shall facilitate Pakistan's transition towards climate-compatible development, all using nature-based solutions to address nature-based challenges. This platform will allow partners to share with Pakistan the dream of a better, low-carbon, and ecologically balanced future. Finally, Mr. President, while countries like Pakistan are willing to think out of the box and as well as act out of the box, we urge that raising emission is essentially seen in the context of specific national circumstances and development imperatives of developing countries, as well as the unfulfilled commitments with regard to mitigation, technology transfer, and provisions of climate finance, all of which need to be met urgently and to be scaled up significantly. Pakistan remains committed and ready to play its part in what has to be a coordinated effort based on a relationship of trust and a partnership with nature. We have to act now, Mr. President, because our collective inaction will neither be forgiven nor forgotten. Thank you very much.
I thank you, Your Excellency.